I'm Bill Hader.
Okay, well, thanks, man.
GordonTheWhale.com.
I was just tapping on my awkward view.
My estimate for the Europe trip was a little off.
I suggest you get a job.
A summer job.
Happy graduation, kiddo.
I wrote for the Gordian Knot. It was a literary journal. No, I've never actually driven an asphalt mixer, per se, but I did once drive my friend's van to Wisconsin on a pretty lengthy road trip. What am I supposed to do? I'm not even qualified for manual labor.
Life after college is not exactly what James expected.
I don't have much work experience.
James? Play for nothing, right? James?
Yeah.
By accepting this t-shirt, you are...
hired.
Now, we get to deal with exciting career opportunities.
Nasty.
You'll get better at avoiding that.
On the job training.
You get a 5-minute bathroom break every 2 hours. I recommend saving a few of those up in case you have to go number two.
And inspiring leadership.
All right, the race is on. We have a winner. Here's this.
Hey, James. Have you ever seen a horse race before?
You really got it going on, right? You got it free!
This is how we met.
The music is great in the film. I'm just wondering, like, do you feel like maybe there's a specific 80s pop song that really, like, symbolizes the film for you?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, thanks. there's so much music.
Did you guys
in
hear that? That was a good question.
That's a high bar. Yeah.
Not
dropping that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not dropping that one.
Well, when I was thinking that it's like a song. To me, it's like a sad love song, or one of those songs
like
that addresses,
song?
Yeah, exactly, like an emo song, or The Cure, or The Smiths, or something.
Totally. It's like Silent Lucidity. Like Queensryche.
Yeah. Or that. Yeah.
Funny, how do you prepare for all your comedic stuff? Is there something you do, or does it just come to you?
No, not at all. I mean, that's kind of like, you know, it's that, the Upright Citizens Brigade, their slogans, don't think, you know, and that's like the first thing you kind of, you know, I took improv classes and stuff, and it was just like, yeah, don't think. And so, you know, yeah, you don't like try to plan anything, you know. I mean, that's what's so, you know, cool about doing movies, and it's great when you have a director that gets that and likes that, you know, or people like Greg and Judd and McStoller, people like that, they're like, oh no, it's great, yeah, no, go with it, yeah, have fun. You know, you don't know, like, I don't remember saying, James, am I pronouncing that right? Like, that line, yeah. I'm like, I don't remember saying that, you know what I mean? But you just are like, yeah, you're just kind of like, and Kristen Wiig's is the same thing, you know? She just is so kind of, you know, we don't sit there and talk like, okay, I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do a thing where I'm talking like, the auctioneer thing, you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
And you're like, you know, I'm going to talk like that, and we, nothing, like, when she does an auctioneer thing, that's the first time I'm hearing it, and I just, you know what I mean? It's just like, just kind of go with it. What you really need is a director that's cool enough to get that. Because a lot of times they go, "Whoa, what are you doing?" Well, that's one of the things. A lot of these people, like Greg mentioned before, like Kristen and I, and people like and Seth and Danny McBride and Jonah, like we're all writers too. So it's like coming from a place that's like you can do that, but you're still in the back of your head, like have to move the story forward. Don't just sit here and you know jerk off.
That's the quote.
Yeah. That's your quote for students. Don't just sit here and jerk off.
Is it ever difficult for you as a director? You have to have a certain amount of control over the environment of the filmmaking process,
yeah,
to have people that are really, really organically.
Yeah, it can kind of go off the rails at times, and it can also eat up a lot of time. And we had much less time to do this film than I did on Superbad, so I had to, you know, limit it a bit. But when you have people who are really good at it, like Bill and Kristen, we did spend one day, I made them come down to Pittsburgh to location. So we spent a day going all over all their scenes and really refining who those characters were. And, you know, and something really nice came out of it. They were not as tight-knit a couple in the original script. And as we talked about it, we just realized it would be kind of nice to make them, even though they're never on the same page and they never agree on anything, they're not bickering. They actually like each other, and it gave me an idea of how to shoot them in the same frame all the time. And also, there's something, working those jobs, having worked in the amusement park, the people who run them are weird. They are kind of like, they kind of want to be in show business. It's like the outsider art version of actors. You know, they're just like, they kind of see themselves as like show people. And we thought that, well, they're kind of like that in Bill with his ridiculous mustache. And
Wait, that wasn't ridiculous.
And
you wrote that yourself?
No, yeah, it was all
the Tom
fake.
Tom Selleck.
Yeah, yeah. It was all fake. And then on one night, the night where I come up and I go, "What are you guys eating?" They're eating pot cookies. Right before that take, it was freezing outside. We were shooting in October, and it was so cold. And I turned to Kristen Wiig and I go, I think my mustache is frozen in my face. And Kristen's like, oh my god, let me see. Oh no. And I was like, action. I was like, oh, let's see. And then we like walk up, hey guys, and then walk off. She's like, let me see it again. Let me see. I don't know. Like that's what I remember shooting that scene of being like, oh man, I really think this mustache is stuck to my face. It froze to my face. yeah. But yeah, we always felt like those characters were swingers, probably.
Yeah,
they
were. And they were off season. Yeah,
off season, and they were incredibly. And we thought they would be incredibly rich. That they had like a Mustang farm or something.
Yeah, it's subtle, but I think that's
swingers. Yeah, comes yeah. Through. Everything's making so more sense.
I remember there was like yeah, kind of a weird yelling. Basil yeah. Fawlty aspect to Bobby too, of like just like tall guy with a mustache screaming. You just think like. As a faulty. I don't know. That's why, like, yeah. I don't know.
But I don't know. I guess I find it amusing people who care a lot about really unimportant things.
Yeah, like the racing game or whatever.
Yeah.
Because I think I mentioned that at the screening last night, but that was Greg's, you know, that's why I love working with Greg is a good example is, like, I initially was like, oh, yeah, so you'll just say, why aren't you doing the racing game and why isn't it working or whatever? And you know, you got to do this, you got to do that. And then as we were rehearsing it, it just seemed organically like I should show him how to do it. And it was like, in my head, I was like, I kept kind of like leaning around the side as we were rehearsing it, kind of. And Greg, because he's a good director, is watching this, and he goes, Bill, just go back there and just show him. You know what I mean? And I was like, okay. You know, I got really excited. Like, you could tell, like, I wanted to do it, you know?
Yeah.
And a lot of times.
Like, even the way, like, he takes his jacket off.
You could tell how excited I get. I'm like, yeah. Like, I get really stoked to, like, show him how to do it. But it was just, like, a natural inclination, and Greg just, like, lets that happen, where a lot of times it's like, nope, we have this, and then we have this, and then we have to move on. Like, we don't have time for that, you know, and which makes sense, you know. Sometimes I get, you know, why people make movies that way, and they make them good. That's what we, you know, Coen Brothers make their movies. They're geniuses.
Yeah. I kind of want to talk about the emotion of the film, because I think we're in this really cool time, and we're mentioning, you know, Judd and all these other people, and now, you know, you're kind of part of that directorial group where you do these comedies, but they also have a lot of heart. It kind of harkens back to maybe like the John Hughes films of the 80s that were really funny and had this one type of humor, but they were also, at the end of the day, you couldn't really peg them as comedy or drama. And I think a lot of people are going to be really surprised, but I think they're going to be really
/disappointed.
coming from Superbad, which is
where's the tits?
Superbad is this really, you know, it's got this kind of this adolescent sex comedy, but it's this kind of really heartfelt thing between these two friends. Adventureland, I felt was I would almost peg it as more dramatic.
I would agree.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people are gonna find that and really be touched by that. Can you just talk about a little bit of kind of the drama and the emotion and what that came out of and what drove you to do that story and using, you know, actors instead of maybe like Jonah, you went with like Jesse Eisenberg or...
Well, I definitely was thinking of movies like Fast Times at Ridgemont High and you know, I was also a kid who, as much as I loved whatever mainstream movies were coming out that summer, I was also the first in line to go see Zelig or whatever. I loved Woody Allen and I loved relationship stories and I feel like so many movies of I felt like there's a period in American comedy that was, you know, they didn't want to make R-rated comedies because they would sell fewer tickets. They couldn't get as many bodies in there. And people like Judd came along and showed that you can make a lot of money with R-rated comedies, obviously. But, you know, it's not just to be dirty. There's a lot of things that happen in life that we all experience as adults that, well, they happen to be dirty, but it's kind of, we live in a kind of repressed culture. You know, human sexuality stuff like that. You know, adult stuff, there's some stuff you just can't talk about in PG-13 movies. And Judd broke that barrier somewhat. On top of that, working with Judd on Undeclared, coming from having made an indie film that was hopefully sort of humanistic, my first film, The Day Trippers, very kind of Shaggy Dog meandering plot, but it's all about character and psychology. I remember being on episodes of Undeclared where we'd be in the writer's room and some joke would kill in the room and I'd see Judd crossing it out with his red pen. And the writer would be like, how could you be cutting my best joke? And he'd say, it's really funny. It's not what the person would do. It destroys the believability of the moment or stepping on the emotion. And as much as, you know, someone like Judd wants to be really, really funny, and he is effortlessly, you know, like me, he grew up on Altman and Hal Ashby and James L. Brooks and Woody Allen, and, you know, thinks you can try to have it both ways, and hopefully it'll be that much richer in experience. For Adventureland, I personally felt that I wasn't seeing a lot of stuff about young adults that treated their emotions or problems in a psychologically believable way too often. I mean, from the indie world you would, and this film is sort of lives in between indie and mainstream. But especially a pet peeve about female characters. I felt like, you know, they're always, in young adult movies, they're the object of desire, and yeah. I really wanted Kristen's character to be a real person.
No, that's true, though, and that's what... I think that's the thing, like, Judd, like, the, you know, and I think a lot of people are doing now, which is, like, yeah, I'm writing a script for Judd and other people, and I talk to people who are writing a comedy, like Simon and Edgar and Nick Frost and those guys, and everybody kind of has the same thing as when you're writing a comedy, you never... The first couple of drafts are never funny. Yeah. Don't even try to be funny. You just know, hey, we're funny. You know what I mean? Like, we'll make this funny.
Yeah,
but,
trust, or I'll hire like, funny people.
I'll get someone funny.
I'm amazed at how tiny my paycheck is.
We are doing the work of pathetic, lazy morons.
Please.
For those who think I feel. Blah, 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 blah.
Oh, we have a loser.
Party at my house tonight. My dad's out of town.
Yeah, I'm invited.
Yep. That's why I'm telling you.
Let's party!
James, every time you meet a beautiful woman, don't you imagine what she'd look like naked?
Coming?
Yeah, you go ahead. I'll be in a second.
Overhead him! Look at this thing.
Yeah!
This spring.
Be cool with that.
From the director of Superbad.
Nice bite, Grandpa!
There's a whole corn dog.
My brother's such a douche.
The worst job ever.
Whoa, you're dead!
We're trying to kill me.
Get out of my doorway!
You don't know what I'm capable of!
Thanks, buddy.
Hey, no problem.
Might just lead.
I love your song. Come on, let's dance.
To the best time of his life.
You get to refrigerate these?
Mm-hmm. Smell weird?
Yeah.
Fry these up.
Adventureland.
I mean, drinking drugs?
I think I had a bad corn dog.
Yeah, don't ever eat the corn dogs.
Let me go on.